Good evening, everyone. Welcome. My name is Federica Freschi. I'm the Dean of the Faculty of Art, Design and Architecture here at UJ. Or somebody once introduced me, she was saying to a group of people, said, "That's our dean," but it came across sounding like, "That's our dean." So I am "That's our dean." And it is my very great pleasure and privilege to welcome you all here this evening. This really is a great event. It's although these premises of the Saatchi Chair in South African Art, History and Visual Culture have been open now for about 6 months. I think this is the biggest event that has been hosted here so far. So for me, it feels almost like a kind of a big public opening of this wonderful facility. Professor Brenda Schwarman is, of course, the NRF Saatchi Chair in South African Art and Visual Culture. So Art, History and Visual Culture. So we're really very honored to have this chair as part of the faculty. And the kinds of rubrics that she's engaged with around questions of visual art history and identity in South Africa, and particularly the kinds of issues of community as well, are very much part of the mandate of the chair. And I think that what is so amazing about this exhibition and this book project that we're here to celebrate, because it is, of course, the launch of Brenda's really wonderful book, which is on sale this evening, and I really urge you to get a copy while they're going, because it really is a beautiful book. I've managed to spend some time with it today. It's beautifully designed, beautifully produced, and it reads incredibly easily, and beautifully. It's very sumptuous in terms of its visual material, and of course you can see some of those works here this evening. And of course the extraordinary thing about these Keiskamma tapestries is that they're kind of... Brenda talks about this notion of parody, that they're based on these sort of famous canonical works in the Western repertoire, but interpret them through the lens of the experience of the women from the Keiskamma project. So they're enormously inventive. They feel, that sense of a slight uncanniness. They're very familiar and yet quite strange. And of course, what they do is they really prompt us, they encourage us to see the world through the eyes of their makers. And I think that is always such an astonishing moment when you have that kind of shift from something that you think you know very well, and then you see it through someone else's eyes. So really enormously compelling. Anyway, I'm not here to give a lecture. I'm here to to introduce our... I'm here to introduce our honored guest, for which that sardine needs his spectacles. But before I introduce Layla, I'd just like also to very specially welcome some of the honoured guests here. Carol Hoffman from the Keiskamma Project is here. Carol, where are you?
Yes, I'm here to see you.
There she is. Hi, Carol. Of course, we have many of the women from the Keiskamma Project here as well. Ladies, please raise your hands so we can see you. So a very big welcome to all of you, and thank you so much for travelling all this way to very hot Johannesburg. Thanks also to Robert Hoffman. I'm not sure that he's here, but he designed the book, which, as I said, is a really beautiful thing to look at and to behold. And then, of course, also to Helen Fossler, who was entertaining us with her beautiful flute playing. Helen, where are you? Lurking somewhere? Anyway, you'll have heard and seen Helen. So with those, a few thanks, there's a few introductions. Let me introduce to you Professor Layla Patel. Layla is the director at the Center for Social Development in Africa here at UJ, and is also the South African Research Chair in Welfare and Social Development. She was previously the Director General of Social Welfare in South Africa and Deputy Vice Chancellor and Vice Principal of Wits University. She played a leading role in the development of South Africa's welfare policy after apartheid. Her research interests are social welfare, social security, social development, and civic engagement. In 2014, she was awarded the Distinguished Women Scientist Award in the Humanities and Social Sciences by the Ministry of Science and Technology. The second edition of her book on social welfare and social development in South Africa was released in 2015, and of course that's one amongst a legion of publications, very distinguished publications. So, Layla, we're very honoured to have you here. Thank you so much.
Thank you for inviting me. Brenda and I met a long time ago when I was at Wits, and she was at Wits too, and in fact, she had her first, and I don't know if it was her first exhibition, in 2000 at the Gertrude Posel Gallery then at Wits, and I also She asked me to open the exhibition then, given the nature of the work and what I do, so we have a really shared interest. And since she's come to UJ, we've reconnected, and it's been wonderful to be with you and work with you again, Brenda. So I just wanted to say how honored I am to share with you a few thoughts with you this evening at the launch of the Keiskamma Art Project, Restoring Hope and Livelihoods, written by Brenda Schwarman and published by Robert Stewart Clark from Print Matters. So turning through the pages of the book, now I'm not, as you can hear, I'm in social welfare. I've got nothing, know very little about art. But I'll share with you what I felt and experienced as a lay person turning through the pages of the book, that it makes a strong visual impression on the reader, and it draws you in to find out more about the story behind the powerful images. The book was beautifully designed by Robert Hofmeyer, who's unfortunately not able to be with us this evening. The art was produced by this amazing group of women and designers who are co-creators of the works and who have been ably led by Carol Hofmeyer. The Keiskamma project is based in Hamburg, for those who don't know, and surrounding villages in the Eastern Cape. So let me also add my voice of acknowledgement to Carol and the 11 women members of the project who have been able to travel to Johannesburg to celebrate the launch of the book. Tebo Mvubu, I don't know if I said that properly, Tebo, who was the primary designer of a third series of the Nsikizi, beautiful tapestries, and the colors are amazing, which is on display, also joined us. I don't know where you are. Everybody can see Tebo? No. Now, just for everybody to see him. So he's the designer behind this work, which is wonderful. Okay. I wish to acknowledge the project, the art project, is one of numerous community art projects in South Africa, such as the Paper Press Program. And I'm so happy to see Kim Berman here, because it was through Kim, too, that I was introduced to all the community art. The projects that she introduced me to at that time, the Art for Humanity, Sia Zama, the Create Africa South, to mention just a few, and I don't know if they're still in existence. But I learned also from Kim that Carol was also connected with the Paper Press Program, so all the connections are very special here. So the work represented in the book has been widely acclaimed and are displayed prominently in the Cathedral of St. Michael and St. George, Grahamstown, Rhodes University, the University of South Africa, Wits University's galleries, art galleries, and the University of Johannesburg, and very proudly in our very own parliament in Cape Town. The works have also been exhibited at the National Arts Festival in Grahamstown over the years, in the UK, and it's also sought after by prominent local and international art collectors, and I hope as you grow stronger, more and more people will buy, because that's going to make a big difference to mainly the women who actually produce the work. So the book is divided into 6 chapters, each describing different works of art. The themes speak to different aspects of South African life as experienced or interpreted by the women themselves, whether it be the frontier wars of the Eastern Cape in the 19th century, the dispossession of land, and the devastating impact of the HIV and AIDS epidemic. Other themes depict the hopes and dreams for the future of the women at the dawn of our democracy. So throughout the book, Brenda provides a rich interpretation of the stories that shape the works. Each of the works of art are discussed in detail and capture its complexity, combining historical and contextual analysis with cultural meanings, gender, and social and economic dimensions. And in the later works, we see here also an appreciation of our natural environment. The descriptions and interpretations are detailed, and the emotions linger long after I stopped reading the book on Sunday. So I'm referring here in particular to the lament for the dead, the Keiskamma Guernica. Having seen Picasso's Guernica in the National Museum in Madrid some years ago, this was particularly striking. We lost so many lives over so many years as a result of AIDS. How this work was conceptualized and produced, and how the artists inserted their real life stories and meanings into the work are as important as the work itself. The impact of the epidemic will be with us for many generations to come. The book bears testimony to our failure as a society to avert such a disaster that should not have happened in the first instance. Given the current political turmoil, I wondered what we have learned from our past. But moving away from the darkness into the light, the book as a whole and the Keiskamma Guernica also provides powerful images of hope, restoration, and the creation of opportunities to improve livelihoods. Over the years, 100 women have benefited by supplementing their income in one of the poorest provinces in the country, and where many women probably survive on social grant income only and possibly some remittances. The Keiskamma Trust provided the light and is depicted in the light bulb in the Keiskamma Guernica, and it pays tribute also to Carol's leadership role in the project, but also what it means to the participants to be part of this remarkable project. Dialogue and critical reflection among the women and between them was central to the creative process. Through self-expression and engagement with individual and collective grief, the women seemed to find much needed solace. The healing power of creative expression, gaining new insights and the release of agency to promote individual and community restoration emerged powerfully across the different chapters. So what is significant about the book? I think that it is significant because it is a representation of what Brenda says are magnificent works of art, and I take the art historian and the art leader's view on that. But also because it simultaneously enhances opportunities to improve livelihoods and creative self-expression. This is the essence of human freedom and development. If I may borrow from Amartya Sen and Martha Nussbaum's human capabilities approach and their ideas of justice. It forms part of a growing number of publications, art exhibitions, documentary photographs, and films on South African art. Some of the images of the community art of the various projects are also more visible and recognizable today through popular media, such as billboards and crafts and arts that are sold at different markets and places across the country. So in conclusion, congratulations on producing an excellent and an authentic book, Brenda. For those who do not know her, Brenda is professor and the South African Research Chair in South African and Visual Culture at UJ. She's published widely on women artists, community arts projects, and on contemporary South African art. And this is her sixth book. I recommend the book highly. Not only is it beautiful, it is based on really high quality research. So thank you.